This is the story of a village, and of the men who want to demolish it because it stands in the way of progress, and of the people who fight to save it because, well, because not everybody likes to see a village die to order. Park is in County Durham. It isn't a pretty place. It's tired and broken down, and ugly and pathetic, and above all, neglected. Once, 4,000 people lived here, miners and steelworkers, the industrial elite of Durham. But today, only 1,000 or so are left, and soon they too will have to go. It's 100 years ago this week that Witton Park officially became a parish, and in that 100 years, industry has played cruel tricks with both the village and its inhabitants. In September 1869, this ironworks was producing 1,000 tons of metal every week. More than 900 workers and their families moved into Witton Park. But in 1882, the factory closed. 1,000 men were thrown out of work, and Witton Park's decline had begun. Today, the site of the ironworks is a dump. The railway lines that carried hundreds of people every day, the 3 miles to Bishop Auckland and beyond, now bring wagon loads of waste to bury what was once the source of Witton Park's prosperity. This was typical of the situation which faced Durham's planners 20 years ago. Industry in the county was dwindling. The labour force of 175,000 miners was halved, and halved again as the pits closed. Housing and communications were bad. They pondered how best to pull Durham into the 20th century. They sat down and made a plan. Richard Atkinson has been with the plan from the start.
And we made a very vigorous analysis of the future potential of the different places in the county with a view to selecting those into which development should be concentrated, those which should grow, those which seem to offer the best opportunities for the future, and on the other end of the scale, and this is what causes the trouble, of course, those which would in the future have to decline.
What did you envisage happening to those villages which, as you put it, had to decline?
We recognized that they had come into existence for a specific reason. Those reasons were disappearing. We understood that people still lived there, that there was still, in many of them, sound property, and that it should work out its economic life. We added to that that, of course, during this period, which we recognized was going to be difficult for the people living there, we should do enough in the way of capital investment to make sure that they had reasonable and civilized conditions. In other words, there was no bulldozer policy, let's sweep it away. It was quite clear that this would have to be a gradual transition done in as humane a way as we could possibly manage.
But has the plan been carried out in the most humane way possible? For 20 years, 121 Durham villages have been actively discouraged from surviving. Some, like Bowden Close, where only 2 houses remain out of 100, have died with scarcely a whimper. Others, like Witton Park, the roads unmade, the empty houses decaying and dangerous, the appeals for redevelopment unheard or ignored, have fought for their lives. Often, the conditions in which the villagers live are anything but reasonable and civilized. Eventually, there will be a new council house for Mrs. McKim, but the house won't be in Witton Park, and the local housing list is so long that the family face yet another winter in this environment. The planners labelled all the 121 villages Category D. The villagers have adopted it as a battle cry, and the uproar has been heard as far away as Westminster. The Tory shadow minister of housing, Graham Page, comes to talk to them.
But in some respects, the administration of planning has gone very wrong. And there are places in this country at the moment where, in the name of planning, there have been created, and there are being created, situations as explosive as the Bogside in Londonderry or Crumlin Road in Belfast. In the name of planning, people's homes have been attacked and demolished. Oh yes, quite lawfully, of course.
Mr. Page contributed little to a clear-headed appraisal of the problem, but he pledged what the villagers wanted to hear, that the Tories would end Category D.
In the name of planning, there has been legal vandalism.
The prospective Tory candidate sits and listens beside his newfound friends in this traditionally safe Labour seat. At local elections, Category D has already become a winning issue. Crovac, the Villagers' Action Group, now has 2 seats on the County Council, 17 supporters on district councils. John Callaghan, a television engineer and chairman of Crovac, has fought Category D for 11 years.
Well, first of all, I don't think that any law in this country should give anyone powers to tell us where we're to live. I always was led to believe, and still do believe, that an Englishman's home is his castle. And the Town and Country Planning Act has given powers to the Durham County Council which have condemned houses which are perfectly fit to live in.
We've had a close look at Witton Park, for instance, and some of the houses in Witton Park are bad. Now, these people have to be rehoused. They have to live somewhere else other than the houses in which they're living.
Indeed they have, and the conditions in Witton Park are terrible, atrocious, and it's an indictment of the county planners for putting this blight on Witton Park, which has created these artificial conditions. I believe that no village or no house could get into this state unless it was by starvation or strangulation, by a plan or a policy. Indeed, the people have got to be rehoused, but the land at Witton Park is good housing land.
And yet the planners, you see, would say it is for their own good that we want to move them into the large new housing estates.
Yes, well, I would say to the planners, are they planning what people want or what they think is good for us? And I say this, and the minister said quite clearly when he spoke to me at Spennymoor, there's no reason at all why the planning committee should not meet Crovac or Eldra or anyone else concerned with planning. This is what planning is about. We're planning for people, and people should be consulted. I want Mr. Atkinson, I wanted him to come here today and to meet these people, and for us to tell him what we require, and then he goes and draws his plan up accordingly. Not for him to draw a plan up for us and say, that's what's good for you, have it whether you like it or not.
The fact is that a good deal less than 10% of the county's population live in the so-called Category D villages. The other 90% live in communities which have a long life, many of which are going to be upgraded and very substantially improved. And I feel that we've tended to get this lot out of perspective.
What is the population of Durham?
The total population of the county is upwards of 800,000, 850,000, something
like
that.
So this is still 85,000 people we're talking about in D category villages?
Yes. It's 10% roughly of the total population of the county.
There are middle-class professional men in County Hall who really have little or no contact with the way of life, the thoughts, the values, the attitudes of what is essentially a working-class community in places like Witton Park. And just how far this gap can be bridged, I don't know. In the 20 years that this particular plan has been going on, it's quite clear that it hasn't been bridged, and there's no sign of it being bridged as yet.
During the past 15 to 20 years, the soul of the village has absolutely been torn out.
Charlie Hewitson was born in a room over this shop 68 years ago. He has never left Witton Park except for an occasional holiday.
Saturday night was a night when people came out, the Salvation Army paraded, they stood on that spot there with a full band, had an open air, and the people came to see what was in the shop windows. People were continually passing, coming in, buying what they needed. You don't see a soul now.
Will you ever move from Witton Park?
I'll have to move. Unfortunately, I'll have to move. My home is in Queen Street, number 30. It's surrounded by 26 houses that are scheduled for destruction. They'll have to come out. Mine isn't condemned. They couldn't condemn it. And there was a lot more in the street. Had the people kept it in the same repair as I've done, they would never have been condemned. But my house has to come out, I know that. Now, I've lived in that house since I was married. And I don't want to leave the village, but I'll have to. I don't want to leave the shops. I'll have to.
In Witton Park, even the best-kept houses are in jeopardy. Mrs. Elsie Bryan has spent £1,500 on hers. Despite the depressing surroundings, she wants to stay here.
But you see Witton Park today, and you hear the people saying, we don't want to move from Witton Park. And yet Witton Park isn't by any stretch of the imagination heaven.
It isn't. But it's my heaven. I mean, you wouldn't like to think you spent all your money in a house not to go get out, would you? Where'd all our money go? What have we worked for? Nothing. Nothing at all.
Would you go?
No, I wouldn't go. I'd go down the pigeon crate down there and live. We have a good pigeon crate. I'd go down there. Pitch a tent down there first. I wouldn't go. The sights I've saw in the new estate. Have you been to the new estate? No, I wouldn't go.
Mrs. Mildred Stevenson and her family live in the last house in what used to be Vulcan Street. She's watched her neighbours' homes demolished one by one.
People didn't want to go, but they were forced to go. The council made them go. I mean, if the house has been kept in repair, there was no need for anyone to go. I mean, my mother-in-law has to go any time. She doesn't want to go. She spent 36 years in that house she's in now.
And it seems to me that to fossilise the settlement pattern just because some coal owner found coal there 100 years ago and ran up a pit village for his own convenience is not in tune with modern economic and social requirements.
But if the people want to live there?
Well, one isn't sure that people do want to live here. Some of the present people, some of the present generation, understandably say that they do. But I think we've got to bring ourselves back to this point, that what we are here discussing is the long-term strategy for the development of the county, the longer-term future, how to get things right, modernised for the 20th century.
10 shilling a line for £1 turn your house.
The economics of owning a house in a Category D village are frightening. The value of the property, once a compulsory purchase order is made, may be as much as £60 or as little as £5, plus the promise of a council house, eventually. Meanwhile, the numbers fall and the demolition grinds on.
On its own, number 8. All the twos, 22. Legs, 11. On its own, number 7.
Yet houses which were scheduled for immediate demolition 20 years ago are still standing. Some are abandoned to become adventure playgrounds bristling with danger. Others are still occupied by families only too eager to move.
What about your children? Now, in this particular road, in John Street, there are more empty, broken down, vandalised houses than there are occupied houses. What does this mean when your children go out to play?
Well, a condemned house which is empty, it's just tight as bands to play in. I mean, little kids at a certain age like to play houses, you know, and they just go in and play, and it's very dangerous. The bottom house, when the wind blows, the wall rattles and it only has to fall down and the kids will be killed. And I mean, I have two that go in and play, and you can't just stop them from going in. You can't keep them inside your house. We can't walk across the back bedroom floor. If we do, it falls in. And as you can see, the front room, the ceiling, it's coming in. There's when you walk across the floorboard is all loose. And the children's feet go down, which you can't help. And the windows, they're loose. And when it's windy, it rattles and it rains in.
Do you want to move from Witton Park?
Well, not really, no. If they give me the house that I'm going into and they put it somewhere in Witton Park, I would stop. Because it's a nice, friendly place.
A nice, friendly place, or a decent home for one's children? Lillian and Tom Hudson are in no doubt as they move out of number 18 John Street. It is 20 years almost to the day since the planners first described the living conditions there as deplorable. For the Hudsons and their three children, the attractions of the new estate at Bishop Auckland are obvious. A solidly built house, a garden for the children to play in, a flush toilet, electricity and constant hot water, no more tin baths in front of an open hearth. For them, it's a new life. For the planners, the attractions of the new estates are equally obvious. Here, the potential labour force may be concentrated. Here, they say, lies the secret of attracting new industry into an area which badly needs it. But the theory has yet to be proved conclusively. And for many ex-villagers, whether the planners are right or wrong is irrelevant. Quite simply, they're unhappy here. 300 people on the estate have signed a petition asking to return to Witton Park. Mrs. Elizabeth Stevenson and her family have already come back after 5 years in Bishop Auckland. They now live in Witton Park's disused railway station.
I had two friends on the estate, two good friends. But it's still not the same as being where I was bred and born. I only have the four children, and each one of them were born in Witton Park.
When you say you were miserable on the estate, what do you mean exactly? I mean, did you go out?
Well, I went with the children for walks and such like, but it just wasn't the same as being in Witton Park. I mean, I like Witton Park. I mean, you could go for a walk around here with your children, but you didn't have to look into houses the way you have to when you went for a walk on the estate.
Well, how will you feel if Witton Park is eventually razed to the ground?
I'll be sad. I'll be truthful with you, I'll be sad. I didn't want to move from Witton Park. I still don't want to. As long as my house stands, I'll stay.
Even though you're told to get out?
As long as my house stands, I'll stay put.
On this question of what is a community, is Woodhouse Close, for instance, more of a community than Witton Park?
Well, if you're asking me whether the old Witton Park, the 19th century Witton Park, was more of a community than Woodhouse Close is today, I would probably say yes to that. But I don't see a direct relativity here, I'm afraid.
Why not?
Because I don't think that anyone has found a method, particularly in the conditions of a difficult mining industrial county like Durham, of recreating in modern terms exactly what we had growing out of the old 19th century forces and conditions. I doubt myself whether it's possible to do it.
Would you not agree that there is nothing to prevent people living in, let's say, Witton Park, travelling the 2 or 3 miles to Bishop Auckland to industry there?
Of course, this is stated in those terms. This is a sensible proposition. But if you ask me whether an industrialist faced with a choice between a compact modern town of, say, 30,000 people or a large number of small isolated villages, if you ask me which he would prefer, then I'm in no doubt that he would go for the modern town.
But which would the people prefer?
Well, I think this is a question that's got to be balanced. I think there is a place for the small community in Durham as elsewhere, probably a very big place. And we do envisage in our development plan the continuation for a very long time of many small communities in Durham. There's room for both.
Yes, and the deletion of many more, of course.
The deletion of 120 small, unsatisfactory places, yes.
St. Paul's Church in Witton Park. A new vicar is inducted by the Bishop of Durham. The village reaffirms its faith in the future. Clings to the rhythms, prejudices, and values of the life it has always known. It guards them jealously, even obsessively. If the planners succeed in sweeping away the debris of 100 years of industry, then the spirit of Witton Park too must go. is the only county in England that has chosen to solve its problems by a policy of deliberate destruction. True, the county council have agreed to look again at Witton Park and three other D villages, but the chances of a reprieve must be remote. Industry went from the village a long time ago, leaving behind only the traditional patterns of life. Yet industry may still have a final trick to play on Witton Park. This part of the high ground overlooking Witton Park is called High Pot Hill. And what's happening here today could prove to be the ultimate irony in this confused situation. This is a National Coal Board drilling rig, and for the past month or so, it's been looking for coal. Well, it's found it, a seam which could yield an estimated 400,000 tonnes. The coal board say they'll start open cast mining in about 6 months' time. And at the most pessimistic estimate, there'll be between 3 and 5 years' work for perhaps 100 miners. But where is the labour force going to come from? Witton Park, with its population halved since 1952, won't be able to provide all the men. So the National Coal Board are going to have to look to the new growth areas, the housing estates. And some of the men who've left Witton Park during the last few years, often unwillingly, are going to have to come back here to work in order to dig out this coal that's been found on Witton Park's doorstep.
I would describe this as something of a red herring. Open cast coal operations in this country are, I hope, a temporary and passing thing. Admittedly, the getting of this coal will require some men to do the job, a lot of civil engineering chaps and people of that sort. But what we're, it's essentially a short-term, temporary kind of operation.
400,000 tons?
Yes, this is considerable. But what we're here measuring it against is the long-term future development and strategy of development in the county. And I don't think that this is more than a passing incident in the game.
Is there an alternative, do you think, to the de-village policy? I mean, can't these people be allowed to remain in their village? Could you not build new houses, let's say, in Witton Park?
If you ask me about one village, and I'm not going to talk about Witton Park specifically, the answer would probably be yes. One could say that the main objectives of the policy and the plan could be achieved if you broke the policy in one place. But if you break it in 120 places and you have virtually no plan, you have a haphazard policy of scattered development, then I think the main aims of the plan would be very severely prejudiced.
Your development plan aims at, and I quote, the right mix of satisfactions, social, economic, and physical. Do you think you've succeeded?
One never succeeds in planning. One is either moving towards one's objective or away from it. What I am satisfied about is that, on balance, we are moving fairly steadily and strongly towards our objective.
How would you say you failed?
I think we failed in the so-called Category D villages to the extent that we have not been able to secure as rapid and orderly and painless a transition as one would have hoped.
What's it like to stand by as somebody at the center of this village and see a village gradually die?
Breaks my heart. It breaks my heart. I can't see any hope for it unless there is the light of the light of a comprehensive redevelopment. And if that comes, the village will come again.
But if they have another look and they still decide that Witton Park must die, if you like, yeah, what then?
What then will die graciously? And I can't say anything else.
It was in 1949 that Witton Park was sentenced to death. Whether or not the sentence was just is still arguable. But today, after 20 years of deterioration, it may already be too late to save the village. Witton Park has been a long time dying. Too long.
Therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust.